Okay, so thank you everyone for coming. Iñaki is going to give a talk today. Ignacio is a friend, but he's also a very good researcher who has worked in ICFO. He did his PhD in ICFO a few years ago, and after that he went to do a PhD postdoc in Lyon in the group of Sergio Chiliberto, and after that he worked in Complutense University until now, when he just found out that he has been awarded a Marie Curie fellowship. So with that, I welcome you, Ignacio. Just one thing before that, he has asked us to turn off our cameras. Normally I ask everyone to turn them on, but I think he has a bad bandwidth problem, so I think it's better if we turn them off. And you know, you can interrupt if you want to ask any questions, or just raise your hand and he'll see it. Okay, Ignacio, please.
Okay, thank you for this kind introduction, Antonio. As he comments, I'm currently working at Juan de la Sierra Fellowship in the Universidad Complutense de Madrid in Thomas Parrondo's group. But my research interest, despite I'm working currently now in a purely theoretical group, are experiments. I make my PhD, my postdocs, and so on, my research state, working with micromanipulation techniques, especially with optical trapping. Optical trapping is a photonic technique that is very useful for studying mesoscopic systems. This ranges from some nanometer to a few microns, and that allows us to hold and manage small objects with different refractive indices suspended in a fluid. There are also other kinds of optical trap working in vacuum, and during this talk we are going to restrict to colloidal particles within fluids. My talk is on the diffusion of colloidal particles in critical bath. So what's a critical bath? But first I want to start talking about that most of the work has been done in pure thermal bath, that is in water or in any liquid, whose correlation is instantaneous. So we are working in a no-memory environment. In this kind of environment, we can take our colloid and displace it in the fluid just to make microrheological measurements. It's very nice because we have minimal invasion of the sample. We can combine this kind of techniques with another experimental techniques or photonic techniques. But most of my work has been done studying the fundamental features of the physical mechanics. We were focused on studying thermal engines, or to study how the second law of the thermodynamics has changed in the mesoscale. So we were able to change things like temperature, for example, design double well potential, connect to different
to induce these thermal jumps, we were able to make more flexible, more complicated energetic landscape. For example, to mimic a decision, we trap a particle between two traps, and then we displace one particle respect to the other, and the particle must choose. And we were able to measure the energetic footprint of this decision making or decision iteration. Today, I will talk about what's happening if we are working with another kind of thermal bath, but where the correlation is non-negligible, where we have some kind of collective behavior. So this is the kind of experiment that we'll present. We will have one or two optical traps that will trap one or several particles. We are be able to track the trajectory of each particle. Yeah. We are able to change the temperature of our fluid, few Kelvin, few millikelvins. And what is nice here is that we are able to mimic a very particular condition that appears in nature. Although all this stuff can appear like a toy model, what we are doing is confining between particles that there are act like confining wall, non-trivial fluids. If we confine a fluid at the edge of the thermal fluctuation, the field of fluctuation changes and appear some forces like Casimir, analogous to Casimir force, Casimir-like forces. So we are going to mimic this confinement of the thermal fluctuation. We are able to work with long-range thermal fluctuation using mixture of liquids, in our particular case, micelle solvent, kind of micelle in a solvent like water. As I told before, we are going to use optical technique like optical trapping. We are going to combine with some light scattering. And we're going to apply in the stochastic thermodynamic framework. That is a framework that allows us to obtain the energetic exchange in the mesoscale using the, our observables, in this case, the trajectory of the particle and the potential energy where they are within it. So this is a movie about our experiment. We have two particles or one particle, and we slightly change the temperature. We go from 28 up to 32 just by focusing another infrared laser, and we can observe that the media stop appearing homogeneous, and some heterogeneous appear. The size of these particles is around 5 micron diameter, and we are able to achieve distance in between the surface around some hundred of nanometer. What is happening here is that the fluid is changing from an homogeneous phase where the micelles are homogeneously distributed to a two-phase distribution where appear one micelle rich phase separated from a micelle poor phase. You see here the two snapshots of the video, here heterogeneous, the media, here completely homogeneous. In this kind of experiment, the experiments in this talk, we are going to restrict to this blue arrow. We are going to work at critical concentration. That's it, that when we increase the temperature, the system jumps, goes from one phase to other in a continuous way. That is, we have a second order phase transition that in the case of binary liquid mixture, follow some universal rule. Here the is following the is in three dimension. When we get closer and closer to this demixing point, what is happening is that the correlation length of our fluid is anticipating the upcoming phase. That is, it's generated some micro regions where the concentration changes, and these micro regions enhance the thermal fluctuations. So when we go, we have our critical temperature of 30 degrees, the correlation length increase up to a great enhancement close to it. This enhancement is following a power law, that is that the correlation length over the its intrinsic value, in this case, the size of the micelle, is following a power law with a universal exponent. In this case, it's the static exponent around 0.63. Over the temperature change. So changing very smoothly the temperature, going from 1 degree of distance to the criticality to 10 millikelvins, we are able to enhance one order of magnitude our thermal fluctuation. This is perfect for our study because, I mean, the colloidal sizes can fit in this range and the distance between the colloids are also well suitable to this scheme. So the state of art of this kind of experiment is quite clear. I mean, that once we confine this fluctuation, this critical Casimir force appear. The fluctuations, the thermal and the concentration profile can fluctuate different within a confined geometry that outside the confined geometry. So if we take two particles close to each other, the different resonance of the fluctuation in and without the confined geometry will make that a force will appear between the two walls. The first measurement, experimental measure of this force predicted in the 70s, were done in the group of Clemens Wechinger with a total internal reflection microscope. So they have a sphere optically trapped, and they confine the fluid between a wall and the sphere, and they measure the displacement of the particle in the z-axis. So they measure that, and from here, they were able to obtain the potential in equilibrium in two cases. When both walls has the same affinity for each component, so this is symmetric boundary condition, an attractive force appear between the walls, vice versa, when they have an anti-symmetric boundary condition, that is, one of the surfaces has a different affinity than the other. It's easier to think about hydrophobic and hydrophilic walls in this case. The point is that these kind of forces are a ratio between the correlation length, that's it, our distance to the criticality, and the wall's distance. It's a finite size induced force. So the other beautiful experiment published in the topic were done in the Volpe laboratory in Sweden or in Turkey in this time, I don't remember, where they had a third particle. So they completely changed the fluctuation profile in the confined area. And they compare which is the force that two of these three body colloidal systems are suffering each other in the case of different boundary conditions. And they see this deviation from the expected value. So this is the proof of concept of this non-additive nature of these kind of forces. But all these experiments were done using a mixture of lutein and water. That is a pure binary mixture, pure binary liquid mixture. Let's have the mixing point around 31. And they are also referred to equilibrium conditions. The system is in complete equilibrium, and they observe just the trajectory of the particle, how it explodes its corresponding phase space. But our question is, what's happening out of equilibrium? Or how these long-range interactions affect the relaxation of the system? Moreover, how these critical fluctuations affect the energetics of the system? There is almost no literature about it. There are some really theoretical papers about the topic, on how these critical Casimir forces relaxes to equilibrium, how the critical interaction affects to the drag term of the particle, etc. But there is no experimental work about it. We present here a solution that is our sample, that in contrast with the lutein water that has an intrinsic correlation length of less than half a nanometer, we enhance that over the nanometer, over an order of magnitude, what gives us more experimental room in order to observe all these effects. What is more important, that is to require less temperature precision for measure the same effect. On the other hand, this sample has a problem, well, not a problem really. This presents a viscoelastic behavior that you can observe here in the power spectrum of the velocity fluctuations, that we have two steps instead to have a plateau here representing the F over 2 diffusion that correspond to two different values of viscosity. At very high frequencies, we have the viscosity of the solvent is dominating, that is, the particle doesn't see the micelles. But when we decrease the frequency, so we increase the measure time, we observe that the viscosity decreases following zero shear viscosity. The change of behavior is done in tau 2.0, which is the relaxation time of the bath, of the fluid. So the first experiment we did with this sample was trying to push in the study of the non-equilibrium features well, the fundamental feature of non-equilibrium behaviors. So we designed a very easy experiment. We have our sample, a critical concentration at a given distance to the criticality, and we have two optical traps that are, each one is trapping a 5 micron particle, and we are able to display this one respect to the other at a given frequency. So we are able to observe how the motion of the right particle affects the left particle. So when we increase the temperature just around half a degree to be very close to the critical temperature, we observe like that the performance of the micro, this nano toy machine, completely changed. The two particles seems to go synchronized, so some force appear that connect the mobility of the both colloids. So in this experiment, we are going to study three things: how the dynamic change as a function of the temperature. That's it. That's the function of the correlation line to characterize the critical Casimir force at equilibrium. Finally, to study a little bit the energetics of the system.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.
So this is what the particle is doing. So you observe that for different realization, when we are far from the criticality, we push the moving trap and the particle within it is following it perfectly. And we have some interference due to the aerodynamic interaction. So at the end, we have distances between the walls of less than half a micron. So the pressure flows are completely non-negligible. So when we enhance a little bit this correlation length, we increase a little bit our temperature, we reduce the distance to the criticality. There are some events where both particles appear to become synchronized. And then when we stay very, very close to the critical temperature, all the events are completely synchronized. So what is happening here? What is happening is that if we study the energetic landscape, when we are far from the criticality, this blue line, we observe here the energy that the particle is following. Really, this is the relative position between the particles. It's much easier to study this system between the using the relative position between the particles and the center of mass. And in this case, it's the relative position. We have our optical trap. And then once we reduce this distance to the criticality, we increase our correlation length, this second well appears. The second well is the combination between the critical Casimir force acting in this part and the electrostatic repulsion between the two particles. So what we are doing is be able to change from one behavior to other, changing less than half a degree. So we change, this is the probability to be in each of the states, completely synchronized or completely non-synchronized. We see that we have a smooth evolution between one state and the other. And then we can use this data, this trajectory, in order to observe the features of the critical Casimir force. We can focus our attention in this protocol, that is a equilibrium position, we displace our trap. We have another half a second or another second of equilibrium, and then we come back to the initial state and come back. So we take the trajectories of all this portion of the protocol, and we, as the system is in equilibrium, we can construct the position probability density function just to obtain which is the potential that the particle is observing, is feeling. This is very contradictory at the beginning, because I mean, we have these forces that are induced by the environment, path-induced environments that are not coming from a potential. But on the other hand, in equilibrium, we can use this trick. Even if not, it is not completely true. This potential is, as we commented before, is we can decompose it, we can split between the Casimir contribution, the optical tweezer contribution, and the electrostatic repulsion contribution, and we can extract this. This is extracting this for two different values to the criticality. The blue is further than the red one. we are able to fit this Casimir potential to the Derjagan approximation. All these forces are following universal shapes. That is not, they are not following analytic version of the force field. In any case, we can see here that this Derjagan approximation of the Casimir potential is increasing with the correlation length, so it's becoming more range and more deeper once we increase. And from here, we are able to fit to have a value of the correlation length. So this is the correlation length of over the whole set of experiments, and we are able to change from 40 nanometers up to 200 nanometers. And finally, in this experiment, another implementation that we can, another game that we can play with this data is to analyze the energetic of the system. It's very interesting to know how the energetic trade-off can be measured in the mesoscale, because we cannot use the usual calorimetric techniques that we use in the macroscopic scale. Stochastic thermodynamics allow us to connect our observable, let's see the trajectory of our colloid, with the energy change, always knowing which is the potential landscape or seascape that the particle is suffering. But it's not restricted to this. I mean, reducing the size of object is not a mere miniaturization of its macroscopic counterpart, but another kind of physics, some people can say, appears. That's it. So for example, the second law of thermodynamics stopped becoming an inequality. We can work with distribution of energetics, and we can obtain equilibrium values like the free energy from non-equilibrium measurements, like the work of the heat. But in any case, at the end, the most important thing is that we are able to link the trajectory of our colloids with the work that is exchanging. We can write the Langevin equation, this is not important. And as I told before, we have the relative motion, that is the distance between the particles, and the center of mass, that is the So we can calculate the work each other. The work is nothing else but the external force, this contour parameter, that is the position of the moving trap. It's injected into the system. So using this relaxation dynamic, we obtain the mean work for each variable. For the center of mass, we observe that remains constant. That's it, because in the center of mass, the Casimir force is not appearing anymore. And we are only observing the dissipation of energy due to the movement of this center of mass, so we are shearing our particle within a fluid. On the other hand, in the case of the relative motion, where the Casimir force appears, we see that once we approach to this critical temperature in that direction, we have a continuing increase of the work that we need, I mean, that the work that is exchanged between the one particle and the other at the end. Because the sketch of the system is that we move the trap, so we inject energy as work in one particle, and this particle, due to the critical Casimir force, is transferring some energy to the particle in the static trap. In the same way, we have a dissipation that is the bound of our system, of our energetics. And afterwards, we observe this increase that we can relate to a change in the free energy. That's it. That's another measure of the Casimir force. We can compare these values of the work, that's it, of the free energy, with the data obtained here directly from the equilibrium measurement. So it's nice that we are able to connect in equilibrium and non-equilibrium measurements with this experiment. The point is that it's not a real non-equilibrium, because there are two things in this system. The first is the first point is the particle in the trap. It's moving here. We change the trap position or whatever. And the other part of our system is the bath. How can we say that? Can we say that the bath can be out of equilibrium if we change very quickly this correlation length? If we change very quickly the concentration profile. How is this going to be related to the trajectory of the particle, I mean, to the performance of the colloidal particle? Indeed, there is no publication about how a particle couples this kind of critical bath. So we did another kind of experiment in order to know what's happening in the fluid and how the colloid and the bath are communicating each other. So we just hold one particle in this fluid, but in this case, we are going as we want to see how the bath affects the dynamics of a single particle. We want to enhance the ratio between the radius of the particle, the size of the particle, and the size of the fluctuation. Therefore, we use a particle with a radius of half a micron. So it's like one order of magnitude smaller than the particles that we use to measure the Casimir force. This is perfectly normal because in the case of the critical Casimir force, what we want to do is to increase the liquid confined between the particles. So working with higher particles, confine more liquid between them. And therefore, with this scheme, we design the following. Well, first of all, let me talk about another thing that is in the same case, in the same way that the correlation length, this blue line, explodes close to the criticality. The time of the bath, so how long this coherent structure that enhances the thermal fluctuations exists before being annihilated? Because remember that all this scheme is because there appear the appearance of metastable states. How much does this fluctuation last? This, in the case of this in 3D, we have this critical slowing down behavior. That is that the system, each time that we get closer and closer to the critical point, require more time in order to arrive to this final equilibrium state. In the case of the correlation length, it is scaled with the static factor 0.63. But in the case of time, it's going with three times in this span. So we expect to have an explosion much pronunciated in the case of time than in the case of length. Note that in the case of length, this is a scale of 10 degrees, we travel from less than 10 nanometers up to 1 micron. It's around 3 order of magnitude. In the case of the time, we would be able to travel from 10 to the 4 to 10 to the 10. So it's 6 times. We can enhance this 6 times from its intrinsic value. So just to try to measure how this particle trajectory depends in the size of the correlation, we design the following experiment. Another problem of this kind of experiment is that we have many things at time. We have our optical trap, we have our detection laser, we have so on. So locally it's very difficult to know what is really happening, because at the end all the temperature of the fluid are controlled by macroscopic thermal bath. That is that we are trying to control the temperature of microliter using things in the macroscopic scale. So we don't have a very elegant access to this parameter. So in order to have like a local thermometer, what we do is have our particle trap, our colloidal particle trap. We have our detection laser, and we are able to displace from far from the detection laser. So we are able to detect how the red laser is scattered by only the fluid with measurement where the particle is within the detection. That's it, we are able to track the trajectory of the particle. So we combine both. And at the same time, in the case of the particle, the trap's position is shaken from one equilibrium position to other following a step function, just to bring the particle out of equilibrium, but a much faster rate than before. Here, we are working in the millisecond regime, but before we were working in the second regime. And therefore, we have this. When the particle is far from the detection laser, on our photodiode, we have the response of the fluid over the light scatter. On the other hand, when the particle is within the detection laser, we measure the trajectory of the particle. So for each temperature, as we increase little by little the fluid temperature, and the experimental point of view is it's not obvious to change this temperature, because at the end what we have is a mixture of fluids. That one, we cross the transition is very, we need a lot of time in order to come back to the previous stage. So each experiment must be tried to be as self-consistent to obtain the maximum amount of data. This is the reason of this kind of protocol. So studying just the particle far from the detection laser, so just the light scattered by the light, we compare the case of the water, where we have, this is the power spectra of the light fluctuation. In the case of water, it's almost flat at very low frequency before this 1/f noise appear due to the vibration of the building and so on. But in the case of the sample, that's it, when we just focus our detection laser in this micelle solvent and we collect the output light, we observe that the light is scattered at a much higher frequency. We observe the change of behavior before the kilohertz, but before, in the case of water, we are restricting, we have to go to several hertz. And we observe this power spectra, as it's a pure diffusion of the light, concentrating a lot of the light, must follow a pure diffusion behavior. That's it. That if we study how this guy evolved with the frequency, this must be around 2. So we can take power spectra different distance to the criticality and feed that to just this guy. We observe that it's pure diffusive, exponent is -2 all the time. But on the other hand, the power spectra increase. So each time we get closer to the criticality, more light is scattered. If we take this A value as a function of the distance to criticality, we can fit, and it's following a power law with an exponent that is more or less half the static. If we stop and try to understand what is happening is that the light is crossing the media, and as we get closer to this criticality, what we have is higher, bigger and bigger structure. But the correlation length increase, the light must go through this media with all these speckles, and the light is more scattered. So the point is, okay, we can use this more or less like a measure of the correlation length. We see where is our critical temperature. We can consider it, or we are trying to transform these kind of measurements in a local thermometer, be able to detect which is the correlation length of the fluid without the need of a thermometer. And then we go to the other kind of experiment. So what is happening with the particle at different distance to the criticality when we shake it or study it at very high frequencies? As I told before, what we do is make a protocol where the trap position jumps from one equilibrium position to other, following a step function. So we have thousands of repetitions of this kind of these protocols, for each distance to the criticality. At the end, this kind of experiments last of the order of 12, 14 hours, as we try to start several degrees far from the criticality, and we increase our temperature at a rate of less than a millikelvin per second. So in the case of the trajectory of the particles, a very useful tool, especially in the case of optical tweezers, has been the power spectrum. The power spectra of a particle, of an optically trapped particle in water, is a Lorentzian. So we have a plateau for lower temperature, lower frequencies, and we have a diffusive behavior at higher frequencies. So this is almost what we observe when we change the temperature of our sample. Here we have the power spectra of the position for different distance to the criticality, and this seems to be almost the same, but this is not true. We can take this as taking profit that this is scaling with f to the 2, we can go to the velocity space and come back to the same behavior than before. Remember that we have a viscoelastic fluid that have two plateaus, two different viscosities, one for high frequencies defined by the solvent, another for the low, for the zero shear, defined by the micelle. Here in this kind of power spectra, we have also the corner frequency of the trap that is given by the viscosity at this frequency window over the trap stiffness. And we have this relaxation time of the bath. But this is the frequency range where the system, where the bath changes its behavior from a solvent to a micelle within the solvent. So what we did is say, okay, how this guy evolves? And in the case of the power spectra of the velocity, that is nothing else but the power spectra of the position multiplied by f squared, we observe that we see a non-negligible change in this. Here we have again the power spectra of the velocity going with this axis, with the blue axis, over the frequency for different distance to the criticality. From blue, that is the colder, or the further from the for the criticality, up to the red, that is the closer to the criticality. So what we did is say, okay, let's take the bound value, which is the behavior very far from the criticality, and let's normalize with it. So that is to divide the different power spectra with the ground level of the power spectra. And what we observe is that this guy remains almost constant for very high frequencies, but around the relaxation time of the bath, a wave appears. That's it. The power spectra at the end is nothing else but the distribution of the energy over the different frequencies of a system. And it seems that here appear more energy. It's like the correlation, the correlated area, this micro region of different concentration that are creating these metastable states that anticipate the upcoming phase. It's releasing more energy, it's giving more energy in this frequency window. So we can take the integral of this guy over a frequency energy, over a frequency window of our interest, and we can try to feed that to a power law. As Antonio commented me before, this is not very nice, but we are trying to do it. So we call this extra energy, repeat like the integral of this curve, of this ratio between the ground level and the actual level, the current level at each distance to the criticality. And it is increasing with a rate, like a power law, with a rate of half the static exponent. Okay, so I repeat, this is again pure equilibrium. We have an equilibrium particle in equilibrium, and we have observed this behavior. Another very nice tool to study the dynamics of colloidal trajectory is the mean square displacement. how much for an interval of time the particle displaces from the origin. Usually, in the case of pure fluid, we can define particles optically trapped. So we have an optically trapped particle. So what we observe is that this increases with -1, with 1, and then is collapsed to a plateau defined by the variance of the particle. In this case, we can observe discrepancies between these feet and the reality of the data. We see that for very small times, we see a strong discrepancy between the feet and the experimental data. But this is very nice for the low or longer times. So we can define the variance of the particle, then for the position of the particle, and the relaxation time. So the relaxation time is nothing else but the viscosity of the media and this and the frequency space that the process is done. In this case, in kilohertz, is going with gamma zero. Here we have for red and blue, these are two independent measurements. One did only in static and another combining dynamic and light scattering and the trajectory measurement. We see how it's going down very quickly close to the criticality. Like if the viscosity at close to the criticality, the zero shear viscosity, highly decay. On the other hand, the variance of the particle, this is kt over kappa, in the space of phase of the particle, it remains constant around 1. We can see a slight this, but it's not, I mean, we cannot say anything comparing the two set of that. On the other hand, remember that we talk about this viscosity kernel, defined by the two viscosities and the relaxation time. We can include that to a generalized Langevin equation. We can forget about the trap because we want to center in the discrepancy points. And we can obtain a value of the mean squared displacement in the absence of trap for this viscoelastic kernel. So we observe that we have different parameters here again. Of course, when the t is going to zero, this is we are coming back to the linear regime of this mean squared displacement. But we have the zero shear viscosity, defined by d zero, tau zero, this is appearing here, and alpha, that is a ratio between the two viscosities. And we can try to fit this data, the data from the very short time. And what do we observe? Focusing our attention in d zero, tau zero, remember that this is where the step between the two viscosities is produced, which is the interval of time where the one viscosity start to dominate with respect to the other. We observe that this is increasing following a power law. Again, we have the red and blue are different set of data given by different measuring time at the end. And the black line is a power law with exponent, exactly the static one, 0.63. We observe that this relaxation time is increasing with this. This is a pity because at the beginning, when I try to measure that, I expect that this is going with 3 times this exponent, but it's apparently it's not going. And this one, that is in perfect agreement, with the change in the relaxation time. Remember that this is given by the exponential fit, so like of an optical trap, of an optically trapped particle in a fluid, and this is given by the viscosity kernel. And this, of the top right and the bottom left, is giving exactly the same information because tau at the end is scaling with 1/0. So in principle, we are able to connect the two feet following this. We observe this critical behavior in tau zero. And the last question to answer, or just to show you, because I'm not going to give a lot of answers, I'm just trying to give questions of our observations. is that remember that the protocol is taking the particle very far from the detection, just to observe the light scattered by the sample. And when the particle is detected, we have a fast change protocol. So we have some equilibrium, we abruptly change the equilibrium position of the trap and jump between them. So we have this kind of protocol. At the end, we displace from equilibrium position delta x around 150 nanometers, the colloid, and we can observe the relaxation of this. Instead of waste more of your time in the relaxation dynamics that is going to go like the D0, we are going to focus to the heat exchange. How much energy is exchanged between the system and the environment each time that we change the trap position? As we have a very, very easy protocol, that this is a step function, and the end, the mean value of the release heat is going with the stiffness of trap and delta x, so the displacement of the trap equilibrium position. That is exactly the same that in a spring that in the macroscopic scale. There are two ways to calculate the release heat. I mean, you can find easily in the bibliography, one that is taking into account only the external force, well, it's usually the thermodynamic one. Another that is taking into account the distance between the particle and x0 and the position of the trap. That is usually called more appropriate to the mesoscopic regime. In theory, if we take this and this, we are completely equivalent because there is a factor x that is easily to prove that is going to zero in the mean. Fluctuation theorems are very useful theoretical tools designed for us generalization of the second law of thermodynamics. Using this theorem, Krug theorem, and assuming that the heat distribution, once we repeat several times the protocol for a fixed temperature, we have the following relationship. The dispersion of the heat over the heat is proportional to the temperature. That is nothing else than the probability to violate in a transient the second law of thermodynamics depends on the temperature. As higher the temperature, higher will be the variance of the particle of the energetics. As Q doesn't depend on temperature, higher temperature only affect to this. So what we did is calculate the mean heat by the two ways, by the thermodynamic and the mesoscopic. We see that these are very, very accurate with the spec value. It's around slightly over 50 kT. But the surprise came when we analyzed the variance corresponding to each definition. In the red one, that is, you remember, only taking into account the position of the trap, the variance of the heat remains constant completely over the different temperatures. However, if we use the other definition, we see an incredible increase close to the criticality. As closer we are from the critical point, a broader distribution of heat we have. So what we can do, I mean, that's the end, this relationship is just to divide one respect to the other. We observe how the first definition of heat completely followed it. It's strictly two of what is should appear. On the other hand, it's going from two, far from the criticality. So far from the criticality, both are seems to be equivalent to almost three times the two, around from four to six. So we can take this, assume that there is like effective temperature, and try to see how it scales. And we observe that the exponent of this increase of the effective temperature is very similar to the exponent and to the static exponent. So at the end, we came back again to the change of the correlation length, but not in the what we expect on the time. Where is this coming? This is a problem for us. Because what we observe, well, not a problem really, but if you remember, this is assuming, this relationship is assuming that we have Gaussian distribution of the heat. But in the case of the first definition, the definition of the heat, take into account only the position of the trap, we see that we follow nice Gaussian fluctuation, red, we conserve the transient fluctuation theorem. On the other hand, in the case that we take into account as a standard force the distance between the particle and the trap position, we observe non-Gaussian fluctuations. So we have these heavy tails that is dominating the variance of the energetics when we are close to the criticality. So now what we are trying is to combine both to excess of energy in this frequency space that is scaling with points with the correlation length, the square root of the correlation length, with these values of the heat. And we haven't succeeded yet. And at the end, to be able to bring this guy out in the skin. How can we make a measure where this time directly appears in our system? So just the conclusion, with this kind of toy models, we are able to change several orders of magnitude operation length of the fluid, of the thermal bath, of the room temperature. At the end, what is happening is that the noise, I mean, the thermal noise is becoming a free parameter of our experiment, what is very nice because we cannot consider it like a passive, always a passive agent. Our sample that is based in micelle solvent, it's a micelle solvent solution, enhance one order of magnitude the intrinsic correlation length, has a longer intrinsic correlation length, what help us in the laboratory reducing the temperature precision requirements or allowing us to enhance more than in the formal bibliography. There is an evolution in the viscoelastic properties of the fluid, and this is one of the directions that we are taking now, trying to obtain to analyze the microrheology of these samples at a different distance from the criticality, how this enhancement of the correlation length affect this viscoelasticity. Moreover, there exists some theoretical paper that say that in the case of confinement, that is like when we confine this fluid, its viscoelastic property will be deeply linked to the arising of forces. That's it, that we would be able to connect the chain, a feasible change in the viscoelastic property with the critical Casimir forces. This non-Gaussian fluctuation, it's appears also in some glassy systems, this non-Gaussian fluctuation, but it's the first time that we observe that in colloidal particles, in working with critical bath. But it's also the first time that we are trying to look at this at this point, I mean, because previous work has been completely focused into the equilibrium features, always the critical Casimir force in equilibrium with 1, 2, 3 x particles, trying to use this critical Casimir force in order to induce change in the multiple colloidal system. But nobody is trying to look at the fundamental features of this interaction, how at millimicrosecond scale the fluid is changing as a function of the particle and vice versa. And the future of this, at least under my point of view, of this framework, of this kind of experiment, is to change the way that we change the local temperature. I mean, we must stop heating our sample with an incredibly large device compared with the system size, because this restricts our measurements. I mean, that's a very nice measurement. would be to be able to travel to observe the relaxation of the field and how changing very, very swiftly the temperature field change the fluctuation field. That is like a word game, fluctuation field and temperature field. Well, I mean, that is the end. We have one publication, two in preparation, in the project. I mean, this work has been done using my fellowship of Juan de la Cierva, but this has been also funded by the CNRS, by two visiting researcher position in the École Normale Supérieure de Lyon. People that has been involved in this work is Adrien Petrosian, Sergio Chiliberto, and Clemence de Bailly. That was just, he is the responsible of obtaining this very nice sample. That apparently it has been started using in other groups. Last week, there was a new paper in Bechinger group where they quantitatively studied the critical calcium force in mice and solder using total internal microscopy. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Iñaki. Is there any questions? Yeah, Pietro?
Okay, Iñaki, thank you for the nice talk. I have a couple of questions just about the first part when you have the interaction between two colloidal particles. In this at the critical point, these particles are 5 microns large. So usually, when you have very large particles, the device screening length is very small, so the thickness of the double layers, and then they are dispersed in a micelle solution, where you basically changing the temperature, you are like changing the conformation of the micelle itself. Could be that this attractive interaction come from polymer depletion, from the fact that when they are pushed close to each other at the critical point, they're basically pushing out these micelles, and then they are actuating as basically an attractive thing, rather than electrostatic, because then you would have also an algebraic dependence that I think can be used to fit the potential.
The point is that we think about all these deflection forces, because there is a very beautiful paper, a PRL from 2010, that they talk about this. But different with the critical calcium forces, we are able to distinguish the deflection forces because they are not universal. And the point is that they depend on the particular features of the medium, but it's in the size of the part of the micelles and so on. So from our measurements of the critical calcium, we are able to compare with the universal shape function, that's it, the Derjagan. I mean, and this is like a fingerprint that is not a deflection force. Moreover, it's not a breach because it can appear too. I mean, when we are getting closer to the criticality, we have too many lasers focused in around the same point. So we rise the temperature locally. So we are for the media below the transition point and in the particular place when we are measuring above. So it's created like a micelle bridge between the two particles and they stick together. But it's again the same. I mean, we don't have this universal shaping. So, I mean.
And then just curiosity about this viscoelastic fluid, if whether it is shear thinning, shear thickening, is power law, which type of viscoelastic is, and how this can affect basically the dynamics in your system. I see that you use always near equilibrium equation. You assume that the Boltzmann statistics holds. This is right when you are not totally out of equilibrium. It's okay. But for a viscoelastic media, maybe when you are moving them, probably you are doing very slow because it's almost adiabatic. Otherwise, you would see some history dependent in your system, right?
Yeah, you're completely right. You're completely right. I mean, that is the kernel that we select. I mean, that is a very first approximation that we find that is almost working. But sure, but for the nice details, we must change this. We must pay much more attention about which are these viscoelastic behavior. And moreover, I mean, that is, we need to do, to obtain the microreology, I mean, that is the complex and the real part of the of G, in order to know exactly what is happening.
Yeah, you can do it. You have the trap, you oscillate without the other particle, and you already get
not really, because I mean, this experiment was done. I traveled 15 days to Lyon, I measured, and then came back and analyzed. So I mean, it's not so straightforward. But yes, I mean, yeah. Now I will have the opportunity to do that. I mean, in a more
macroscopic rheometer.
Yeah, or with a macroscopic. But this is going to use only the zero.
For curiosity, in the Bechinger case, when you have this lutidine, this is not viscoelastic, right?
No.
Ah.
It's a pure two liquid. Yeah, I mean this is the two points. I mean that is, in the case of lutidine, we have a very friendly environment because everything is very fast. But as it's everything is very fast, it's almost a dream in trying to enhance the non-equilibrium feature of the bath. Mm. On the other hand, when you have heavy things, I mean, like myself, you slow down the dynamics of your bath, but you have all these viscoelastic things. Yeah. But
you choose it for the correlation length, basically.
Yeah.
Okay, very nice experiment, the talk, Ignacio.
Thank you.
I think Raul has a question.
Yes, I have two small questions. Also, by the way, it was very interesting presentation and subject. Could you talk a little more or explain about the, you mentioned a specific concentration about micelle and solvent. About the solvent you mentioned is water, but for your particles, they have a specific kind of treatment like SDS or what kind of?
Well, we have a mixture, a micelle solvent mixture that consists in water as solvent and pentethyl glycol, et cetera, as micelle. I mean, this is a surfactant that is non-ionic, that has a hydrophilic head and a hydrophobic tail, that in this, with this parameter of concentration, that if I remember correctly, is 1.2 in mass concentration, the critical one. And at room temperature, it's distributed micelle. So the point is that when we increase the temperature, the interaction between the micelle change, and then we have these two phases. If it's very clear, I mean, that is one, you have a region where you have a lot of micelles and region where you just have water. The way to proceed experimentally with this sample. This sample is not very nice in the under experimental point of view because it has a high hysteresis. If you try to manipulate with microfluidics, just by shear with the pipes is the mixing. You cannot treat with UV because the surfactants are not UV lovers. And you shift the surfactant when you irradiate with UV, so you cannot sterilize your sample. So at the end, you have some bacteria or whatever appearing. So it's not nice. And this is one of the reasons because I wanted to turn to from this thermal bath, where I mean you will agree that if you want to change the temperature in the middle, you are going to have a higher temperature in the border, so the phase transition will appear first in the border. You will have some affinities in the border, so you are going to change the concentration profile for in long time. If we were able to, with an extra laser, just change the local temperature of interest, trying to find a plateau of temperature in a micron scale, that would be a great kick for this kind of experiment.
Yeah, I guess it was trial and error, but also very particular to find the specific concentration to find the phase transition. Yeah, it was great. And about the second question is about when you have these two particles together and also they separate, I assume that these are plastic particles, but yes, but I mean, I don't understand, or maybe I get lost about why they separate, because they usually tend to, once they touch, they stick together.
No. But,
I mean, I'm not sure if this is that Casimir force or
yes,
why not another molecular force or van der Waals, something different.
Yeah. I mean, the first time we did the experiment, I didn't trust the data. I think that this was a liquid bridge, because it feels so strong that, I mean, that is, this is not going to be Casimir, it's going to be another thing. The point is that once we analyze the trajectory, in this case, we take, if you see this protocol, the protocol is just, we are close together, we get further, we stay further, we come back together, we stay together in equilibrium. So taking this equilibrium stage, we are able to obtain, as Pietro say, the Boltzmann, using the Boltzmann equation, this interaction. Because at the end, we measure for this trajectory thousands of times. So we have lots of points in order to be able to have a smooth position density function. So fitting this to the Derjagon approximation allow us to discriminate between artifacts and real Casimir. And on the other hand, it would be very, we would be very, very lucky to have a perfect agreement between the evolution of the Casimir potential that is dominated by correlation land. So this nice evolution with a power law that agrees with the measure of, with the expected value of the correlation land.
Okay, so thank you, Ignacio.
Yeah.
Is there any further questions? If not, let's thank Ignacio and thank you all for coming. And I'll see you in a couple of weeks. We have another seminar. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your attention. And I expect the papelito. ¿Te quedas un momento, Antonio?
Sí.
Un minuto.
Bye. Bye, hasta luego, Ignacio.